We're back. I'm Alex Holmick.
Chris Tomato Harfenist here at Tomato's House of Rock in New York City. And we got a very special guest coming in, our first international guest.
Yeah, he's all the way from Finland. He's from a great band called Children of Bodom. He's a great vocalist. He's a shredder on guitar. And we're excited to have him here.
Coming all the way from Finland, international shredder, metal legend with us here today to come into our studios in New York City and talk to the Thor Metal group.
So Thor kids, a big Thor welcome to the one, the only from Children of Bodom,
Alexi Leho.
Yeah! Come on in!
Alexi, welcome to Thor, New York City.
Well, yeah, good to be here, man.
Yeah, how's it going? So you're on tour.
Well, I just got here like 2 days ago. You know, I'm doing promo and stuff. Came back from LA and also doing promo. So the new album was supposed to come out on June 11th. So basically, that's what I've been doing. You know, just waiting for it to you know get the thing out.
You've been doing this since early 90s.
Yeah, I guess back in like 1993 when me and my drummer, we just kind of like, you know, started effing around with, you know, he had a drum kit, you know, I had a guitar, you know, and I started playing when I was 11 and yeah, so at 13, you know, we started playing covers, so you know.
What were you guys listening to in Finland
just
at the time?
Basically anything from, Poison to Sepultura or Slayer, you know?
Nice.
So that's how it was, yeah. And that's how it still is, actually, believe it or not.
Poison.
I love Poison.
Motley Crue.
Hell yeah.
Can't go wrong with Motley Crue. Mm. They ever come to Finland, all those hair bands back then?
Yeah.
Yeah,
they did.
Yeah.
But I mean, I was just way too young to, like, you know, see any of the cool, any of the cool ones. So anyway, we started playing, writing songs, and then we started making demo tapes. I think the first demo tape came out in 93, so I was like 14 or 15 years old.
Wow.
Start planning those demos, kids.
Start making your demos.
It's a good idea, and it's like, I mean, it seems to be a lot easier today anyways, you know, because back in the day, you know, we would have to actually have the cassette, you know, and put it in an envelope, you know, and send it out to a record company and just hoping to hear back.
We had to actually go into a studio.
Yeah, you have to rent studio
time.
Yeah,
we went to many places, too,
So now everybody has a laptop.
Yeah. You know,
there is no excuse.
GarageBand.
Yeah, exactly.
Usually singer guitar players just play rhythm, you know, mostly play rhythm, at least traditionally, in, like, real heavy music. I mean, I heard, you know, there's this band. The singer plays guitar,
right?
But he can really play. He's good. You should check him out. And then when I heard of it, found it was no joke. But were you always a singer guitarist, or did you start out as just a guitarist?
I wanted to be just a guitar player originally.
We all do.
Yeah, right. And
we couldn't find a singer.
We couldn't. It's like, you know. Nobody wanted to sing. They were like, well, I don't want to do that, dude. You know, it's like, I'm too shy or whatever. I was like, you know what? Forget about it. I'll do it. You know, whatever. I don't care. And unfortunately, I ended up being the singer.
Unfortunately.
It was a big mistake, obviously. Yeah, right. obviously,
you,
it worked out very well.
Were you self-taught on guitar? How did, like, what guitarist were you listening to become, you know?
I went to music school. I started with violin when I was 7. Well, before that I started with piano.
Is there a lot of classical music in Finland? I mean, is that classical training?
Yeah, it's pretty well known. And so I went to this classical music school like at 7 years old. And when I started playing guitar at 11, I went to this other kind of music school that they were all about, mostly about jazz and, you know, that sort of thing, and just learning musical theory and stuff like that, and you know, taking guitar lessons, you know, musical theory, transcription, you know, the whole nine. And I did that for about 6 years. And then that, you know, by the time, by the sixth year, you know, our first album was out and we were basically touring already, so I couldn't really keep it up with the school anymore.
But and how old were you at that point?
I was 17. Right. Or 18, I think.
When you started hitting the road?
Yeah.
Wow. And the other guys in the band all around the same age?
Yeah. We got an awesome hookup from Nuclear Blast, the German record label, which are one of the biggest ones at the moment.
And Testament's on there,
yeah. Oh yeah, you guys remember them too, yeah. And so they hooked us up with like a bunch of tours in Europe, which was a really good thing for us. So they put us on the road like nonstop. We were always doing something. So basically, the whole band, you know, since we started so young, you know, we have spent all of our, you know, adult lives on the road,
and
yeah, that's how it really is. But I mean, I don't mind though. I mean, I still love it. You know.
And you're in California part of the time.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, you live there too?
Mm.
Or you spend time in
it? Yeah, I live in LA like, you know, half the time. And depending on what's happening with the band.
Can you write metal songs when there's all that sunshine?
Yeah, what do you do?
The West Coast.
You know, people ask me that a lot, you know. It's funny. It's funny, but I can, however,
SPF, you got
it. I would say, you know, it's a funny thing that the last record that I did write, that was all in Finland throughout the fall and the harsh winter, and it you can actually hear that. It's a funny thing that, you know, but it does make a difference, sure.
I mean, obviously, you know, Slayer's from Southern California. Testament's
well,
from the
Orlando,
Bay Area.
A lot of Orlando.
There's a lot of bands from sunny places, but there is a certain sound, I think, that European bands have, especially Scandinavia.
The funny thing about the Finnish metal scene is that now it's like kind of blown up with this new genre of, like, I just call it folk metal, you know, it's kind of they dress up and
power metal.
Pointy ears.
Oh, like Finjol?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I saw these guys. Yeah.
I don't know what is it called? Like,
it's
there
folk metal?
Folk metal. Yeah. It's huge over like all over Europe, really.
Really.
And and most of those bands are from Finland.
Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean,
you guys gonna get a flute player? Is that next?
Never.
All right, good.
Yeah,
you're here.
The flute.
Yeah. It's a trend, man. It's a trend.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
Come on.
Keyboards is one. Keyboards.
Yeah.
You made that cool. But
bearskins.
Yeah. You don't want to push it.
Come on. Yeah. It's 2013. We're supposed to be in like
the future.
Tubes and spaceships.
Yeah.
Hello, Alexi. I'm wondering how the Britney Spears cover came about in your band. How'd you guys, I mean, it's obviously not a metal song to begin with, and like, how'd you make
really?
It really, like, how did just like,
what's
the story with that?
it was really just a silly thing that we came up with, you know. It was, the Britney song was on one of our tour bus, like a party CD mix sort of thing. And you know, we just always pop that in, you know, when we're having a good time and blah blah blah, yeah. And so basically, you know, we had that Britney song looping over and over, and then, you know, somebody got a bright idea that, hey dude, we should cover this song. And I was like, yeah man, let's do it. And we're like, dude, I really mean it, let's do it. I'm like, yeah, why not, you know. And basically, I think the whole idea was just to see people's reactions, you know. But mind you, though, you know, we really did put a lot of effort on the cover. You know, it's like really professionally made, and you know, like, you know, the arrangements and stuff. You know, so it's just not like a total joke thing, you know.
I was just wondering if you ever had a tour experience, like opening for a band that you like idolized as a child, and if that, how that affected you, and like what that band may be or what that opportunity may have been for you.
Yeah, I did open up for example, Hypocrisy, that I mentioned before, and I was basically up there, you know, watching those guys every single night, you know, like what they do, like how they act on the stage, you know, and like how they put his foot on the monitor, you know, like when he does that, and you know, like every single little detail, you know, I was basically observing, you know, like the whole show. And it's a really good idea, you know, if you ever get a chance to see a band, you know, that you really admire, you know, ever get a chance to play live with them, just watch them, you know, don't even like, you know, don't take a glance anywhere else, you know, just really observe.
Hey, Lexi, I was wondering, when you were a kid, was there one band or one album or one guitar player that really inspired you to pick up the guitar?
Well, there were many of them, but I would say that the last nail in the coffin was "Passion and Warfare" by Steve Vai, because when I first heard that album, I was like, "What the hell is going on right here?" Like, you know, is that like, you know, I did not know that, you know, guitar could be played this way, you know, and I thought it looked cool, you know, like, you know, all the crazy stuff he did on stage Yeah, it's just so gnarly, and I'm still a big fan, you know. So I think he was like, you know, when I saw that guy, I was like, all right, that's it. I gotta start playing guitar.
Singer in Hypocrisy, and about how he like really observed him and noticed a lot of his things, a lot of like his mannerism stuff. And I've like had the same thing when I like saw Decapitated play, so I like really connected with him when he said that. So I thought that was awesome.
Found it really interesting when he was talking about differences in living in California, was it?
Yeah.
And from Europe Finland. To California, and especially with the noticeable change in sound when they were recording in different places.
And his accent.
Yes, his accent.
Wonderful.
Was
awesome.
And his hair.
He's Squizgar.
Yes.
You know?
I love his hair.
And that was a beautiful experience.
It was very interesting.
To Downfall, I was like, this song's awesome, especially the chorus, like, and like when it goes up, and it's like,
that's awesome.
And it's like, you just want to dance because you're so happy.
My name is Jennifer Hernandez, and the reason why I'm here today is because a keyboardist was needed to play with Alexis, one of the Children of Bodom songs. This has been a dream come true because in Cuba we used to play with Escape. We used to play Bed of Razors, which is one of Children of Bodom songs. And I never thought I would actually get to play one of their songs with one of the members of the band. It's been amazing. I'm very happy.
to thank Alexi Leho. Yeah. All the way from fucking Finland to come down here and play with us, come to our studio here, and thank you so much, man.
Yeah,
thank
it was you. Really awesome.
No problem, dude.
Killer.
And the Thor kids.
Yeah. Rock and roll. Rock and roll. It's all about rock and roll.